because I was an English language teacher on the island at the time, I was always coming into contact with the Japanese population at large. I taught English to medical students, is who I primarily worked with, and one of them happened to know a traditional healer named Yuki. And I had talked Yuki. About, yeah, Yuki.
Interesting.
I had talked a little bit about my personal experiences. You know, you try and keep your personal life out of teaching English as much as possible, but
right.
a little of it creeps in. And it was getting to the point where I was suffering. My health was deteriorating. I wasn't getting enough sleep. Food was bad for me. Finally, I said, okay, put me in touch with this traditional healer. We'll see what happens. And it's not that I was skeptical of the traditional healer.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that at the time that I happened to be on the island, Japanese and American relations weren't the greatest. And so it was politically difficult for me to do.
I see.
And because she was local Ryukyu. And for those of you who aren't familiar with the Ryukyu island chain, the Ryukyus underwent something similar to what our Native Americans underwent at roughly the same period of time. Japanese colonialists came in, took over the island because of its important trade in East Asia, and sent all the native peoples off to the far-flung areas. And then once they decided they wanted those too, well, then you have to conquer the native peoples. And that's who the Ryukyu were. And Yuki practiced the traditional medicine, the traditional ways of the island prior to Japanese conquest. So she came over to the house and she alarmed me. You know, spiritual people, magical people, they always are a little bit peculiar. So I wasn't too surprised when she burst through my front door and started slamming windows shut.
What?
Her prerogative. Yeah, that's what I thought too. And she says, oh my dear, oh my dear, oh my dear. And she's shutting windows. She says, oh my dear, shutting windows as fast as she can.
Wow.
And she says, first, if you're going to open a window, either have the thing open or not. If you leave it in halfway, halfway comes in. And I thought, oh, now there's a bombshell piece of information.
Oh.
If it's open halfway, things halfway come in. Oh. And then, as if that wasn't bombshell enough, then she struck her fingers across one of my tables. I was, of course, the Martha Stewart in me was horrified because she came up with this dust that I had been unable to control. And she says, oh dear, oh dear. I'm like, God, I'm a horrible housekeeper. I'm a terrible person. I'm embarrassing the entire United States of America at this point.
Okay.
And she says, quick, quick, help. You live downwind of a crematorium.
What?
I know. The hairs on my arms stood up. And when I realized what was covering my furniture, I too started running around the house going, oh dear, oh dear. So after we had, you know, wiped up all the people off my tables and chairs and vacuumed and dusted and then she said, never, ever, 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 ever open your windows on days when that smell happens.
Because wow.
I had smelled something bad,
wow.
but I, prior to that, had lived near, I'd lived near a paper mill, and paper mills have just horrific odors. Anyone who's ever been near Covington, Virginia, knows that horrible, sickly, sweet, weird smell. I just thought I was another sickly, weird, sweet smell. I thought there was a paper factory on the island. No, it was a crematorium, and
wow.
it was just like literally across the street from my government apartment. And so then, after we got all that mess taken care of, she says, okay, it would take me to the to where you pray. And so I took her to my altar, and she says, okay, now show me how you pray. And I did, and she says, oh, well, my, then, I guess, okay. And I thought, oh, so there's a hatred of witches even among these people. And she says, no, what you're doing looks so close to traditional ancestors' worship on this island. I think you're just really making the ancestors angry because they think you're doing it wrong just to be, you know, like that as a foreigner.
Interesting, you know, that that the local spirits, that the genius loci, that the local spirits of the place would react in that way.
A very violent reaction.
And especially downwind of a crematorium, I can imagine.
Oh, I was pissing off every ancestor on the island and their entire lineage. It was not a good scene for me. So she showed me an Okinawan house cleansing ritual. And we did that. And then afterwards, she taught me the basics of Okinawan ancestors worship, which is called Sosin Soshai.
Mm-hmm.
And by virtue of having been taught these traditions, there's a lot of spell casting that happens.
Uh-huh.
Because she said that these are, you know, traditional rituals. And then I watched her cook this and that on the stove, and I thought, oh, these are spells. Oh my God. She's teaching me all these absolutely fabulous traditional pre-Japanese island spells. And I just soaked up as much of it as I could. And now, most of this material is completely oathbound. That's one of the things that I had to, you know, zip it or you don't learn it. That's right. Basically what they told me.
So I understand that. So this is sort of where you came from with your spell working together with your witchcraft training and,
yeah, well, you know,
and all of these things. You're an Alexandrian witch queen, I understand.
Right. And I grew up in the Appalachian Mountains, and there's a tradition of root doctors there, and everybody practices a little bit, even, you know, even the really hardcore Christians. So
you come at this from the real sort of shamanic, down-to-earth, spell-casting sort of...
Popular, witchy side. Yeah, it's common magic. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not limited to a trained priesthood. This is stuff that anybody with a kitchen and two brain cells to rub together can figure out.
Well, this could not be more different than Golden Dawn magic. That I can tell you for sure. You see, well, we'll talk about that. Go ahead. Mm-hmm. Oh.
Okay. Oh no, that's okay.
All right. So
I'll let you cut in.
Okay. Yeah. Well, you know, with Golden Dawn magic, an emphasis on spells per se, but there are ways to make things happen. I mean, the system is not designed specifically to make things happen in the outer world. I mean, that's number one.
Right. Yeah.
But we can, using Golden Dawn magic. For example, for anything you can come up with a spell with, there's a way that we can handle it using high magic.
Right, because you need a sledgehammer when you're going to kill a fly.
So here we are, right back to the debate between high magic and low magic. And that's what we're looking at today, a little bit the differences between high magic and low magic, and see if we can end this rivalry once and for all.
I think so.
Well, okay. Explain to folks a little bit more about how high magic works. Okay, so in the Golden Dawn, we use astrological magic primarily. We work with the forces of the elements, of the planets, of the zodiac, and of the stars. And there are practical applications of it, but when you're working with those kind of stellar forces, except for, you know, the elements, which are very immediate, then you really need to have some sort of a focal point for your energy and for your will for the magic to manifest in the physical plane. Now, there are several ways to do that. And the best way to do that is with the talisman. Now, the Golden Dawn has a very interesting and sort of complex way of making talismans, We use geometrical figures that correspond to the sephira, or the position on the tree of life. Mm-hmm. This wonderful glyph that we have from Kabbalah called the Tree of Life.
Oh, yeah.
And the positions on the Tree of Life correspond to different planetary forces and different zodiacal forces and different elemental forces.
Mm-hmm.
And so we use these correspondences. And for example, Venus, the number seven.
Okay.
So we would use, like, for a Venus talisman, a heptagram with seven sides.
Right.
And then we have flashing colors.
Pretty.
You know, yeah, they are pretty. and not just pretty, but powerful, because when you juxtapose colors that are exactly contrasting one another,
mm-hmm.
it sets up a very interesting vibration mm-hmm. and gives it great power.
Right, yes.
On top of that, we have the invocation of the Kabbalistic angels and the Kabbalistic archangels, which is why at times these are known as archangel talismans.
Ah, okay. Interesting.
Let me show you.
Yeah.
Let's see here.
Is that?
All right, I got this here.
Okay.
All right, let me show you. Let's see here. Okay, here are some talismans. All right, these are planetary talismans.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're nice and big.
Yeah, well, you know, you need to be able to cut them out and consecrate them. Sun, mm-hmm. Mercury, Venus, Moon, then you have the Zodiac.
Now, would I wear this, or is it a focus?
Well,
or?
It's traditionally the best thing to do is when you, once you consecrate the talisman,
mm-hmm.
you keep it close to you. It's okay. tradition that you carry it around with you, you keep it in your pocket somewhere, or even sleep with it under your pillow until what it is that you're trying to manifest actually happens.
Oh, okay.
So these are talismans right now for the Zodiac, and these are talismans for the Sephirot of the Tree of Life. These
oh,
are for,
right.
for spiritual forces. They're a little different because, you see, the
yeah.
the Sephirot, since they're passive forces,
uh-huh.
you use the heptagon for Venus.
Right.
Whereas here, for example, where was that? Where was Venus? I'll show you. Here it is. Here's Venus as a planetary talisman.
Oh, same colors?
Same colors, because it's Venus, and it's Netzach, but you use the heptagram instead, because it's an active force. The planets are the paths on the Tree of Life.
Mm-hmm.
So, now, you know what?
Nice.
Let me see if I can mm-hmm. let me switch this camera, and I can let folks see it a little bit closer, how these golden dawn talismans work.
Mm-hmm.
We started talking about Venus, so I'll show with Venus here. Here, I think that would be this camera here.
Oh, it's this one.
Oh, sorry. All right, camera three. Okay, can you see now?
Yeah, we can see good.
Planetary seal,
mm-hmm.
symbol of Venus, and then you have around the outside,
mm-hmm.
and the names, the Kabbalistic names of power of the hierarchy that corresponds to Venus. So we in the Golden Dawn tradition, oh wait, let me show folks the rest of them.
Yeah.
We didn't get down to the bottom of it yet. Let's see here. Not on that camera, I won't. Hold on, guys. We don't have a camera person here. We're doing this. This is just a family operation. So let's get a little like this. Okay. So let's see, here you have Moon, and then the zodiacal talismans, and down through. And okay, then down through the elements as well.
Mm-hmm.
So here's fire, for example.
And all then, right.
You know, the rest of the elements all have their talisman as well,
mm-hmm.
with the Kabbalistic
Right. So, very nice.
All right. So that just gives you a bit of an idea the way that work with practical magic with the Golden Dawn.
Right. Well, you're trying to bring something in, right? Yeah. Well, would you like to see what low magic would do about that?
Show me.
Okay. All right. I'll just step right over here.
Here we go.
Here's an egg.
An egg.
An egg, yes. Now, depending on what it is you want, you can get many things with this egg. For example, here, let me finish my water. For example, you were talking about Venus, and Venus is love. Okay, well, I'm going to turn breakfast into a love spell. Are you ready?
Okay.
Okay. I do not break this egg. I break your resistance to my charms. I do not open this egg. I open your heart to my affections. I do not throw away this shell. I throw away your inhibitions when you are in my presence. I do not drink this egg. I drink in the essence of you.
Very, very good.
Now, you don't have to eat the egg raw, but it does make the spell go a lot faster.
Right. Well, you know, don't worry, folks. I got a trick up my sleeve. We're at a disadvantage when it comes to practical magic to begin with. But anyway, let me show folks a little bit because, you know, there are a lot of people here that are interested in high magic.
Of course.
And
of course.
Let me show them how this works, actually, if you're going to, here, let me.
Yeah, this, yeah, yeah.
This comes from.
Oops, oh,
I'll get it. It's okay. This comes from my book, The Ritual Magic Manual. And this is a manual for practicing Golden Dawn magic on your own. The physical book has become really, really rare and really, really hard to get. This is my own personal copy. Leslie's bound it for me quite nicely here. And what I'd like to share with you is from something that I deliberately buried in the back. Now, you see, Golden Dawn magic is not supposed to be primarily a system of magic for manifestation of things in the world. It's a spiritual system. In fact, it's oath-bound as a spiritual system.
Oh.
Although it does work as well,
sure,
for manifesting things.
Kind of like a life hack.
Let me show you how. Okay, what I'm going to be showing you is from Practical and Talismanic Magic. It's in one of the appendixes, and I put it there because, you see, all of the rituals are here. How to invoke every single element, every single planet, every single sign of the zodiac, all of these different forces. But in the rituals themselves, what you will never find is what to do with them, what they're good for, what the rituals are for. I buried in the back. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I did that is because I wanted people to use these rituals for spiritual development. Mm-hmm. Not for practical magic, but they can be used for practical magic, and all you got to do is look in the back of the book and you find out the key.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the way that this works is similar to astrology. If you think about it, elements, they're the forces that are the closest to us. I mean, you can work with elemental magic to manifest things very, very well. Mm-hmm. I mean, Chris Minostra and Israel Regardi, about the only thing that they did magically together was the opening by Watchtower, but they did it together over and over and over and over and over every single Sunday for 9 months with the intention of a resurrection of the Golden Dawn in the United States. And we all know what happened after that. Opening by Watchtower, because you're invoking all of the elements, and balanced disposition is an extremely powerful ritual for manifestation.
Mm-hmm.
But Now, for example, if you wanted, let me show. I'll show you guys in just a minute. If you wanted, for example, to something for money, just take something that people love.
Well,
it's very, very, very practical. Okay, you could do either an opening by Watchtower, where you're invoking all of the elements together in balanced disposition, or you could do an invocation of Earth. Invocation of Earth will get you money.
That makes sense.
But if it's your career that you're concerned about, and not just the money, if it's your life's work, then you're better off not to work with the forces of the elements, but with the forces of the zodiac, because the houses bring the forces of the zodiac down to Earth in the 12 primary areas of life. I'll show you this in just a moment. Wait, I didn't load it to show. Let's see. Well, you know what? Let me do better than that. Can you hold this for me for a second? Okay, guys, let me, let's see here. Where do I have this at? One second. I have for you the practical magic section right here. Okay, I'm giving you right now a link for free download of the practical magic section of the Ritual Magic Manual. Click that link, download free now, and you can download it and you can look at what we're talking about right here. So you have it right in front of you too. Okay?
Fantastic.
Yeah, that's the best way to do this. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, and then I show you. They can look on at home in their own copy. Oh, and you've got yours there too. Didn't she bind these nicely? They're marvelous. Okay, let's see here. Okay, so just to give you an idea. So the planets themselves, they represent more drives in the human being. So you would use a planetary invocation in order to improve your personality and sephirotic invocation for spiritual growth. Now, you can use also the zodiacal forces through the houses to work practical magic as well, but more to improve different areas of your life. When you're having a problem with one life area, then that's the force that you should invoke. For example, if you have problems with marriage or partnership, you want to invoke Libra.
Oh, right.
Or you make a Libra talisman, right, in order to improve your relationship. Mm-hmm. Then, for example...
oh.
But, you know, if you're having a problem with your career, what I was talking about before, you would, as you see right here under Capricorn, the related concepts to the 10th house are profession, career, employer, government, other authority figures. So if it's a career problem, you'd want to work with the energies of Capricorn, the 10th house, instead of the energies of just Earth.
Okay.
So that's it. For those of you who with Golden Dawn Magic, that's a big gift I just gave you, because
it really is, you
see what's for. You don't really find this about Golden Dawn Magic anywhere else.
Yeah, I have never run across it anywhere else, frankly.
Well, this is the way to adapt Golden Dawn Magic for low magic games, or to make things happen in the outer world.
Right.
Let's put it that way.
Yeah, that does make.
Did everybody download this yet that wants to? I'm going to take it down now. I'll leave it up for just a minute more, okay? All right. We'll leave it up just for a sec more here. Okay. All right. You had a chance to download it by now. There we go.
All right.
Boom. Okay. So, yeah, all right. So this is the way we would do it, with a talisman and with and according to choosing the force, according to what the nature of the intention is, what it is that you need to fix or what you want to accomplish.
Mm-hmm.
Now, okay. I see that, you know, we are at a disadvantage. It's a lot easier just to crack an egg.
And of course, if you do it every morning, I make you mine every time you drink it. I make you mine. You go through the whole thing.
Now I get suspicious. All right. So let's see. Right. How about, I know where we get you. Spirit vision.
Nope. Sorry.
I mean, the Golden Dawn.
Yeah.
We not only invoke the forces, but we travel in the spirit vision to those places.
Yeah. You want to see it?
Let me show you.
Yeah. You
let
show me.
Let me show you.
Look, you show me first.
One second.
Okay.
Here we have spirit vision maps.
Oh, these are your maps.
These are maps of the inner planes. These squares has the name of an angel and represents a different combination of energies on the inner planes. These are like coordinates on where we travel to in spirit vision.
Fascinating.
So these are, for those who may not be familiar with these, let me show you a little bit. These are Enochian tablets.
These are great.
Yeah, these are the classical ones that were adapted by McGregor Mathers. I wish you could get a little closer to that.
Well, here, you want me to hold them? I can do the Vanna White thing.
Why don't you? Here.
Okay, you tell me what it
looks like. Right, that's fine. A little bit further back. There we go. Okay, there we go. Now they get a good look at them. So this is the Earth tablet. You know what? Let me come around there.
Okay.
This is better. This one is helping me. This is the Earth tablet. And just to give you an idea, Mor, Dial, Hektiga are three important names, very, very powerful names that are drawn, three angels from this tablet. And then we have also, for example, Yggdrasil from this swirl here. This is the king of the tablet. And there are hundreds of angelic names and also locations on the inner planes in this tablet. Let's see here. Here we have fire and water. You've probably seen some of these before, guys. This, however, is something new that you probably haven't seen before, the Jupiter tablet. Yeah, it's good. Jupiter tablet. And here you have, because you have each of the seven planets going down this way and across this way, so you have a different combination of planetary energies in each of these squares, and the angel of the square also represents a different energy. So this is another map of the inner planes at the planetary level. Mars, Mercury, Moon, Saturn. And this is the planetary tablet of union, the Sigillum De Ameth, which was used to scry in the spirit vision on many occasions by Dr. John Dee, the founder of the Enochian magic system. The Sun, Venus, and the Zodiac. So you have also different angels, angelic names, which are derived from this tablet, and different places in the heavens that you can travel to in spirit vision according to each one of the squares on here. I explain all of this in the appendix of the Ritual Magic Manual, how these were derived and exactly what you can do with them and where they come from. So anyway.
All right.
So, you know, to make things very simple, I mean, you know, we have very sophisticated maps of the inner planes in the Golden Dawn in high magic.
Right. Yeah. Okay. And now everyone gets to make their own map. We don't provide a map. You get a drum and you go to the place where your ancestors meet and you look for a guide.
Interesting.
Everybody's got an ancestor who used to do this. Everyone has an ancestor who has done this. there are hazards and pitfalls with this method. You don't talk to bugs. Don't ever talk to bugs. Dragonflies, they're of questionable importance. I mean, oh, we've got loads of rules. Loads of rules because we've got no map.
We have those too. We've got rules too. Like, for example, you know, since the lower astral is the realm of delusion, we have systems, like you said, no bugs. We have systems of testing division, like grade signs and using Hebrew characters that the magician actually uses in division in order to transform it and to test what he's being told by the entities that we encounter in the spirit vision.
Right, because we've got loads of tests that as traveling drummers that we go through to make sure that we're talking to things that are worth talking to, because it's just like walking down the street, you know? When you walk down the street, you see hundreds of people. Not every one of them is going to be able to answer your question. The one that answers your question may not actually want to. That's the nice thing about just being able to ask, you know, you show up to where your ancestors meet and then, oh, may I have a volunteer? And, you know, for the do-it-yourselfer who's not afraid to step in horse excrement every now and then in the path to figuring out your own, carve out your own way, make your own wheel, then, but man, if you've already got a map.
That makes it a lot easier.
That is great. A map with the locations and the names and everything already figured out.
See, yeah.
With the drumming, every person has to learn all that on their own. It's a lot of work.
The vision is very spontaneous afterward. I mean, mm-hmm. You know, the invocation is kind of like programming the coordinates into the GPS.
Okay.
And then, you know, and then the spirit vision is basically driving the car to get there.
Got it.
But there's a lot of, during that period of driving the car to get there, there's a lot of spontaneous stuff that happens. In fact, it's all spontaneous. This is the difference between true spirit vision and the sort of fantasies that we see being peddled a lot in the New Age community.
Oh, heavens. They've got that with the shamanic technique, too. You know, I've done guided shamanic journeys. They have value. Mm-hmm. It depends on what you need to do. It's just like anything else.
You know, it's very important that in spirit vision, very, very important that there is spontaneous imagery and that the vision is tested. You have to test the vision as well. It's
always
really
tested.
Most people think that it's really difficult to have spirit vision. It's not. The problem is turning off the inner critic, because they see it and they think they don't, because it's got to be something else, because this is something that happens all the time. And it's just using your imaginary faculties in a certain way. The difficult part is discerning the false from the true once you're there.
Oh, and see, that's even probably more difficult than the shamanic technique, because 9 times out of 10, you don't have... Yeah, that's nice.
So we're seeing some significant differences between high magic and low magic here in certain ways. Interesting. Yeah. Very interesting.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, I'm curious. One of the things that I run into my low magic practice with very often, connect. It's true that you make low magic certain particular and peculiar techniques for shielding ourselves, keeping ourselves safe.
This is very important. Very important.
It is very important.
We have this in high magic as well. From the very beginning, we have the lesser banishing ritual, the pentagram, which is a purification and protection rite.
Purification and protection at the same
Which
time.
Is something similar to what you do in casting a circle in witchcraft.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Well, they do look kind of similar, I've noticed.
Yeah, they do. Well, they absolutely do, because Gerald Gardner borrowed a lot of material from that Aleister Crowley stole from the Golden Dawn.
Okay,
Crowley.
Just a second. let me just say that... Okay, witches, here's the hard part. Right now, I am in the desert, and I am experiencing spring. I mean, full-blown spring. Grass is coming up. Flowers are coming up. We have a little Kefra-like beetle that is emerging from the ground now. So the sky's filled with bugs. It's great. But I go back to that book by Janet and Stuart Farrar, A Witch's Bible Complete, where they talk about Imbolg being the witch's spring. And I think to myself, gosh, this sounds suspiciously like the tradition actually originated in the desert. Why would you call February 2nd the witch's springtime? I understand about the giving birth and the milk and all of that, but it happens at the same time in the desert too. I mean, people's foals are dropping, calves are dropping, baby goats are dropping, cats are dropping everywhere. You know, everything's giving birth right now. And yeah, it's full-blown springtime outside, like I said. 72 degrees and partly sunny.
The other protection rite that we give in the Golden Dawn right away is the sign of silence. The sign of one of the two signs of the neophyte grade is designed in order to close yourself in an energetic shield. But what matters more than anything is the intention. You're actually closing yourself in an energetic shield.
I see.
And so we actually have that as well.
Okay. Yeah, shamanically, we've got this thing that we do. We believe that every time you touch somebody, it creates a little string of energy that connects you to, of you.
Mm-hmm.
And so we witches are very cautious about these little strings. Witches and drummers and pipe carriers and others are cautious about these little, you know, like you accidentally bump into someone at the grocery store and then all of a sudden you start experiencing a lot of bad luck. You know, we witches are actually careful with who we touch because of our belief in these cords and these attachments. And so, you know, we have a couple of rocks and we trim off the little connections. There's something that keep a couple of rocks in the shower and just wherever anybody's touched you recently.
Interesting.
You can go ahead and trim that connection. If it's a connection you want to trim off, you think of the person and then you think of where they touched you and then you just trim off these connection cords.
Interesting. Fascinating.
Yeah. It's not a very well-known technique outside of the community, but it's not protected by any initiatic tradition. Yeah, it's kind of like astral scissors.
I love it.
Yeah.
It's great.
I like yours better, combining the purification and the protection at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's a good system.
The real thing is spiritual development with the Golden Dawn. I mean, we've been so far talking about the ways that Golden Dawn magic can be applied to practical magic. But like I mentioned before, it's an oath-bound system for spiritual development. So it's kind of, you know, using Golden Dawn magic for practical magic, it'll work. But as you know that I spell work and teach spell work together with you.
You know, spell work.
And, you know, to be quite honest, in the end of the day, I would say what you want to use it for. I'm not much of a sectarian. Personally, I'm an eclectic.
Yeah, I mean, even Bruce Lee was an eclectic. Eclectics really have made huge advances in our world.
Well, yeah, I mean, and you know, it's like this. A carpenter in his toolkit has a hammer, he has a wrench, he has a screwdriver, and several of them, of course, probably. But at the end of the day, I mean, you can, if you had to, in a pinch, you can hammer in a screw with a hammer. You use a screwdriver.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's why I think that, you know, it's better to use that are appropriate to what it is that you're trying to accomplish. So in that, I grant you, when you're trying to accomplish simple things in the outer world, very down to earth, very concrete things, yeah, there are some advantages to spells because they're designed for that and they're simpler to use because of
Who's using them?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. And this doesn't mean that high magic doesn't have its virtue, though.
Right.
You see, high magic is best used for what it's there for, which is spiritual growth.
Right.
And this business of spirit vision is a part of it, because the most important thing that we're trying to teach people to do mm-hmm. is to wake up on the inner planes and realize that there's more than right. just this physical plane of existence, that we can be conscious on other planes of existence as well, here in this meat suit.
Well, no, we're not trapped here in this meat suit. We can wake up on the inner planes, but I mean, some people aren't even awake here.
I know. Yeah, I'm aware of that. You know, well,
now
we've had our rivalry about this. We've gone back and forth, and I grant you, okay, that maybe this egg is a little bit simpler to break than for what it is that you're trying to accomplish than an elaborate invocation. But if I were trying to transform relationship to love in general and the kind of woman that I attract, I would be much better off working with Libra or with Venus.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, this is a this is a fun time spell. You know, I don't expect to attract a life partner with a 30-second spell. Anybody, I'm going to spend the next 30 years with it. I'm going to use more time than 30 seconds. Give me
right.
a break.
Exactly.
So I can, you know, I can see the definite benefit in that.
Now, this doesn't mean that there's not a conflict going on, though. And we talked, yeah. I mean, in the promotion of this webinar, we talked a little bit about magic wars. And there is a magic war going on.
Yes, and this is actually a rather important topic for us to be covering right now.
Yeah, I think so too. You know, in fact, many of you know about it already. Last year, Leslie and I led two rituals, one at the winter solstice and one at the summer solstice. The one at the winter solstice had the intention to bind Daesh, and also known as ISIS, that had been goose-stepping through the Middle East and destroying, throwing people off of buildings and destroying cultural
archaeological
ruins.
Artifacts.
I know.
Looting museums.
And something needed to be done. So mm-hmm. we did something about it. And not only that, but for me, what was the straw that broke the camel's back was when they started taking slaves.
Beheading, okay, very 10th century. Slavery?
In the 21st century.
Are you bleeping kidding me? Slavery, like actual people in shackles standing on blocks of wood in line with animals being sold as slaves.
Slavery is a problem. And slavery is a problem at many levels. It's a much greater problem than one might imagine, because we're not just talking about physical slavery, where there are slaves being sold on the auction block. But there are many subtle forms of slavery that are being employed on this planet as well. And, you know, this is why our second ritual at the summer solstice was for emancipation from slavery. And because, you know, it's not just the problem that we saw Daesh goose-stepping through the Middle East, taking slaves, is just the outer manifestation of something that's going on magically. Mm-hmm. And what that is something that I've talked about a little bit in previous videos, and mm-hmm. I think it's time to mention again now. And that is that there are certain magicians who enslave the human race.
Yes.
They want a race of slaves on this planet. And they have been working for that for a very long time. And they continue to work for it today. You know, we white magicians, especially of the Rosicrucian ilk, have been fighting these guys for a long, long time. And in the Hermetic lineages before the Rosicrucians, we've been fighting these guys. We've been fighting this tendency of darkness, this tendency of slavery, this tendency of wanting to bind humanity into a dark and narrow place. This is a magical war, and it's been going on for centuries. And what I wanted to point out is that we need to take our time once in a while and enjoy our victories as well. And, you know, I don't want to say that it's all because of our ritual and everything like that, but, you know, we see Daesh about to be subdued now, America and Russia getting ready to go after them together.
Yes.
And we see also, and this is very important, mm-hmm. we see also that the American people in my lifetime mm-hmm. have woken up to what our media is really all about.
Yes, and this is our media. It really bothers me. My training in anthropology touched on a subject I don't know if many people are familiar with. It's called applied anthropology. Applied anthropology. It is the study of how to make cultures change in a specified direction. Going to graduate school, those who practice applied anthropology were seen as the worst types of filth and worse than just worse than anything you could possibly imagine. These are the people who created special cartoon characters to sell cigarettes to children in Mexico.
Oh my God.
Okay? That's who an applied anthropologist is. That's somebody who thinks it's more important to pay off their student loan on time than to have some sort of ethical standing. Absolutely run amok in American advertising. It is absolutely unbelievable the level of weaponization of what is spewing out of our television.
And not just advertising anymore. I mean, it became very clear during the election that the media were not objective at all. Mm. And in fact, they were, you know, spinning false narratives on many occasions and continue to do so today. And what's unique, they've been doing this all along. Mm. What's unique is that now, for the first time, the American people see through it. Nobody believes it anymore. I mean, if they want people to believe their bullshit, they have to go and put it on Jimmy Kimmel because nobody believes what they're saying on
right.
the news anymore.
It has to be thrown out there as
filtered
humor.
Through comedy.
Right.
And they're not just doing it there. Programming. My goodness. Every single series is now. Look, the problem is that 3 years ago, they took away the laws that kept the CIA from using propaganda in the United States. And that was the end of it. The floodgates broke loose. We are now in a situation. Let's be frank about this. Let's be clear about this. We are now in a situation in the United States. Media is openly at war with the American people. Daily basis, waging psychological warfare here in our own country against our own people. And that needs to stop.
Absolutely, it needs to stop. One of the fastest ways to make it stop is to turn off the television. Don't let the demon in.
There are some concrete things that we can do, and that is to continue with our magic. Mm. Look, it's like, I don't want to get into political discussions with people. And I know that people are so polarized right now. This is not about Trump. This is not about Hillary. This is not about liberal or Democrats or Republicans.
But
this
there are two sides.
This is about freedom. It's about freedom versus slavery.
And these are the two camps.
And whether, no matter what your political stripes are, I think all of us can agree that freedom is a lot better than being enslaved.
Yes.
And that's why, you know, I ask you to include in your prayers or include in your magic, continue to put out intentions for the liberation of mankind, for the freedom of mankind,
yes.
for the spiritual ascent of mankind, for the spiritual ascension of mankind.
Yes.
And the Golden Dawn magic is so useful.
Oh, yes.
Because it is a magic of spiritual liberation. Point of it. It's not magic really to be used for making things to happen in the world. You can. I've showed you how today. Mm-hmm. I've showed you the secret of how to do it, buried it in the back of my book. And I also confess to you why I buried it there. Mm-hmm. And that has to do with the fact that, you know, that I'm trying to get on the system for what it is, and that's for spiritual growth. We have in the Golden Dawn system of magic, mm-hmm. the most pristine, incredible system of spiritual emancipation that there is, liberation, that we begin to, from the elemental level, we begin to, you know, refine our energy bodies, our Luke's bodies, so mm-hmm. that they're not operating just at the level of the elements, but that we begin to bring out also the planetary energies. We become more subtle and we can perceive into those finer dimensions.
Right.
You know, we liberate ourselves from the earth through the planets, ascending to the stars and stellar consciousness. This is what Golden Dawn magic is really all about.
Right.
It's about solar ascension. It's about spiritual emancipation.
Fantastic. Yeah.
Well, anyway, mm-hmm. you know, so much for that. Yeah, I know. I think we've settled our rivalry. But look, guys, let me say one last thing, and then I'll surrender the floor to you. Look, rituals last year were so unique because people came together. It wasn't just Golden Dawn magicians. Witches came together with Golden Dawn magicians and shamanic practitioners, drummers, magicians of all stripes, chaos magicians. We all worked together. People were fed up with Daesh, and everybody wants to see emancipation.
Freedom. Yes.
Freedom.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to live in a world where we have a one world government where there are cameras on every corner and everything that you do is registered. And there's no point in that.
No, there's not.
People can be free. Why not let people, you know, open things up so that people can express themselves and create freely? I want to see humanity rise to the highest level of creativity that it possibly can.
Yes.
Not to the lowest level of enslavement that it possibly can.
Right. Yeah. Golden Dawn magic with the spiritual elevation. You know, to be fair.
That's the point of it.
That's really, well, then there is no rivalry at all between us. And there's no rivalry at all between low magic and high magic.
Well, there's not.
No, the real rivalry is between slavers and liberators.
This is the real problem. And this is not just a rivalry. It's an active war. It's a magical war that's been hot for centuries. And guess what? This last year is the first time that we scored a real victory in a very, very long time. Look around today. Things are a lot different than they were before. Mm-hmm. People are awake. Mm-hmm. People are freeing themselves.
And what is enlightenment but to be awake?
Exactly.
And if you can't, gosh, people are so excited about waking up on the astral plane. Psst, wake up on this one first.
Wake up on this one first. Yes, this is very important.
It is very important.
Turn off the TV.
Oh, gosh.
That's something else. As long as we're talking about it, I'm sorry, this wasn't what I intended on talking about today, but this is the wonderful thing about Magic 101. This is unscripted, teleprompter free. We've got, you know, I've got this here so I can control the cameras and things.
Right, right.
And I mean, we don't have a big studio. This is a family operation. And by the way, you've got a link up there for the Ritual Magic Manual. If you don't have it yet, you might really want to get it there. I put up some links for the talismans and the tablets as well, because this is the way that we support ourselves, and the way that we bring things like this wonderful free webinar to the world is by the wonderful, wonderful patronage that we've been receiving from the esoteric community. We're deeply, deeply appreciative.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much for supporting the work we do, and we continue to bring you spells to make your life easier so that you can free up time and get on with spiritual development.
The Illuminati have cast a powerful spell on the peoples of the earth, and while many still sleepwalk like zombies in a trance, they have prepared everything nearly to enslave humanity under a new world empire.
Of our hearts, the power of our magic, and the strength of our numbers, we still can break the spell put on our people.
We're just a ragtag bunch of magicians armed only with the power of our prayer and the power of our faith and the power of our magic. But whether you be Christian, Jew, Wiccan, pagan, magician, shamanic practitioner, or any other stripe of spiritual warrior, of humanity, against this evil falls to us.
So we, who now, to stand with us against the rising darkness, because you and others like you, you're our only hope. I put a spell.